Autism now affects 1 in 59 children. And while advances in research have helped us all better understand what the disorder is, we're still learning new things, like how it affects girls and boys differently, and what other medical conditions can be associated with autism. Dr. Tom Frazier is here. He is the Chief Science Officer for Autism Speaks, which they have a big gala coming up. We'll talk about that in a little bit, but you're here to educate us just a little bit more. You just got back from a big conference in the Netherlands?
Yes, yeah. Thanks for having me.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah. What was the big, you know, news out of that?
Sure, yeah. Well, there's a lot of things, but I think one of the really cool things was the idea of using digital medicine. So, for example, being able to use your iPhone as a parent to help a pediatrician screen for autism. So the iPhone has a camera. The camera can actually detect where the child is looking, whether or not they're responding to their name. So it gives a much more quantitative, objective way to screen for autism, and it can improve our existing methods and help pediatricians to make a proper referral.
That's fascinating. We were just talking about there's differences with boys and girls. I mean, we mostly associate autism with boys,
right,
generally.
Right. Yeah. Well, there's a reason for that. I mean, autism occurs about 3 to 4 times more in boys than girls.
Okay.
So that's the obvious reason. But we're also learning other things, too, that I think are helping us to really understand these differences between boys and girls. So an example here is that we found out that girls are much less likely to show restriction of interests.
Okay.
So restriction of interest is where you get really focused on an individual topic, like dinosaurs or Pokemon or baseball scores or whatever that is. And girls just don't show as much of that, right? And they're also a little more socially motivated.
Okay.
So because they're more socially motivated, they're not showing some of the unusual signs or symptoms. They're engaging in something we call social camouflage, which is sort of being able to fit in a little bit better with their peers.
They can compensate better.
Yeah, they can compensate better. And also the other thing that may happen in girls is that some of their peers may actually just bring them into the group. So a little bit of helping them to compensate by including them more, whereas boys tend to be, you know, a little more rough and tumble and maybe not as inclusive in those situations. So that's come out, and we've also learned about brain differences too. So it turns out that girls with autism, that their brains are not quite the same as boys with autism. In fact, the social parts of their brains function maybe a little bit better. They're a little bit more normalized.
How about, it's really important for parents to understand how to handle their child. This isn't just all on maybe working with the child. You really need to work with the parents.
Right, absolutely, yeah. And I think this is something that's come out over the last couple of years that's really important for people to know is if you train a parent in some basic skills, just how to promote your child's development, how to help them behaviorally to make sure that any negative behaviors that they show, that we're replacing them with positive behaviors. If you give just a modest dose of that parent training, the kids whose parents get that dose, even 3 years later, are doing better than the kids who don't get that dose. And so it's really important that we get parents that kind of training, and especially if your child has been diagnosed with autism or if they're at risk for having autism because they have an older sibling with autism, we need to get parents as much of that training as possible because ultimately the developmental trajectories of these kids is just going to be so much better.
The sooner they get the help, the more important, and you know, again, educating the parents to
when
help
parents
them
are with the kids, especially when they're younger, almost all the time, right? So they're the really primary way in which the child can get better and receive intervention.
We still don't know where this is coming from.
Well, you know, the CDC found a 15% increase. You said 1 in 59. Part of that increase is because we're identifying girls better, and we're also identifying Hispanic children and African-American children better. So part of the increase is just better identification. But there's a part of that increase that a lot of us believe we just don't understand yet, and it's real, and we have to understand that. You know, it may be a little bit that we're waiting longer to have kids, and when you do that, you're at higher risk of having a child with autism. It may be a little bit of prematurity. Premature babies are living at rates that they didn't used to live at, and those babies are at risk for autism and other developmental disorders, but it could be other things as well, and we need to understand that.
Yeah, all things we need to keep looking at, and that's why we have you here. And that's also why this weekend some of Northeast Ohio's most talented chefs are coming together for the Autism Speaks Chef Gala. It is Saturday at the Cleveland Museum of Art. Tickets are still available for that, so great event. And coming up, we're getting a preview of that from our friend Chef John Selleck, and of course, he's sharing a mouth-watering recipe. Steak lovers are going to love this, so stay tuned for it.